My broad heading has been caught at his successors. And one successor is Hegel. One successive type of philosophy is idealism. Now, another kind of successor to Kant and a successor to Hegel is the philosophy of Karl Marx. Marx's philosophy has been called dialectical, just as Hegel's philosophy is dialectical. The difference is, Hegel's philosophy is dialectical idealism. It's a view that everything is mental, everything is ideas. But Hegel also believed that once you understand the process of mind, you also understand the process of nature and history. So there's not a complete division between thoughts and realities. But anyway, for Hegel, he's mainly an observer of thought. And for Marx, Marx is known as a dialectical materialist. So for Marx, the basic things are not ideas, but rather material realities. And that's where I begin on the lecture outline. The basic forces in history to Marx are not ideas, as Hegel thought, but economic relationships, specifically what he calls relations of production. That is, the relationships between owners and workers. There's a duality, there's a conflict, a dialectic, if you will, between owners and workers. And that is a zero-sum game. When the owners make a profit, they make that on the backs of the workers, okay? When the rich become richer, the poor get poorer. You get that rhetoric among in some of the political discussion today. The war on the rich. Well, that begins in Marx. I mean, I'm not saying that Obama is a Marxist, but there's a similarity in rhetoric there. It's a zero-sum game. When the rich become richer, the workers become poorer. Now, you know, in classical liberalism, or in what we call now conservatism, what we call free market economics, economics is not a zero-sum game. I mean, in a good economy, the rich get rich and the poor get rich too. Or as the slogan goes, a rising tide lifts all boats. So what you need is a good economy, and everybody will be happy. The rich get rich and the poor get rich too. But the Marxists say, no, that can't happen. If the rich become rich, it's always at the expense of the poor. And if the poor are going to become more equal, the only way they can become more equal is by taking something away from the rich. So it's a zero-sum game. The duality, then, this conflict between the owners and the workers, inevitably produces class struggle, since the interests of the two groups are incompatible. The owners inevitably accumulate capital at the expense of the workers, who get poorer and poorer. This discrepancy provokes revolution of the lower class against the higher class, which in turn produces a new social order. Now, in past history, history before Marx's time, history before the 19th century, there are similar dualities, there are similar class struggles, the struggle between the master and the slave, the struggle in the medieval period between the lord and the serf. Marx thought that in the 19th century, the chief struggle was between the bourgeois and the proletariat. Now, this is terminology from the Industrial Revolution. The bourgeois were the people who owned the factories. The proletariat were the people who worked in the factories. And, of course, there are all kinds of problems in the Industrial Revolution, diseases that came through chemicals and coal dust and so on. And nobody was very happy with the state of people working in factories. But Marx says basically the only way that this can be dealt with is through a revolution where the proletariat rebel and take over the means of production, take over the factories. And so the communist revolution seeks to bring about a dictatorship of the proletariat, and hence the ownership of the means of production by the state, which is operated by the workers. So the workers and the bourgeois exchange places. Now, this is a revolution talk, but the revolution is not the final stage. The revolution is not the final goal. The final goal is a classless society. So the revolution provides a temporary order, and that temporary order attempts to teach people how to work for the common good, not to work for their own profit, not to work to improve themselves, but to improve the whole society. And when that happens, and that will happen according to Marx, eventually you'll reach a situation where you don't need the state anymore. The state is the administrator of force. And when you reach this higher level of being, you don't need force anymore. You reach a classless society where everybody is doing what's necessary for the common good. And then this slogan comes into practice: from each according to his ability, to each according to his needs. You produce for the sake of the common good. If you're a plumber, you do that work. If you're a farmer, you do that work. If you're a government official, you do that work. So you work according to your abilities. And but instead of making a profit off of that, you put it all into a big pot. And then if somebody needs food, they go to that big pot. If somebody needs medical care, they go to that big pot. So they receive according to need. You produce according to ability. You receive according to need. So that's a wonderful picture, isn't it? Kind of an eschatology, moving toward that classless society where everybody is changed morally. You see, there's moral change, not just economic change. There's a change in people's hearts, change in people's attitudes. And it's really a secularized version of Christianity. It's a secularized version of biblical eschatology. Now, Marx had a number of views on philosophical subjects. For one thing, ethics. Marx thought that ethical systems attempt to justify the interests of classes. So the upper class advocates its own ethical standards that really are aimed not at seeking justice, not at producing mercy, not producing a good society, but rather of meeting its own goals, meeting its own desires. So when somebody comes along and preaches ethics, preaches religion, they're not trying to improve society, they're just trying to improve their own lot in life. They're doing what they think is best for them. Now, so the bourgeois present a bourgeois ethic, and says Marx, after the exploited class, the proletariat in his time, after the exploited class becomes self-conscious, it develops its own revolutionary morality. And here, good is what promotes the revolution, and evil is what hinders the revolution. So there's no objective ethic. There's no objective justice. There are principles which promote my class. If I'm middle class, I have an ethic that promotes the middle class. If I'm upper class, and I have an ethic that promotes the interests of the upper class. And that's all there is to it. There is no absolute morality. There is only a relative morality relative to class. And so Marx, I think that's important to know this. When your kids go to school and they have their flirtation with Marxism, which many students do, of course, in secular universities, and they'll come home and and they say that I've become a Marxist, Daddy. And you say, well, why have you become a Marxist? Usually they'll say, because Marxists care about the poor. Usually they'll say that Marxists advocate justice in society. And I think at this point it's nice to point out, no, Marxism doesn't advocate justice. Marxism believes only in relative morality, relative ethics, ethics that are relative to one's class. So what Marxists advocate are advantages for the lower class over against the upper class. They don't advocate anything like objective justice. When you get to the dictatorship of the proletariat, good is what promotes progress to the classless society, evil is what hinders it. As the interests of your class change, of course, then morality changes. The most frequently mentioned example of this was when communists in the United States back in the early 40s were opposing Hitler until Hitler made a treaty with Stalin, and then all of a sudden Hitler became a good guy because he was allied with the communists. But then, of course, Hitler attacked Russia, and when that happened, Hitler became a bad guy again. Well, see, it's not a matter of objective moral standards by which you're evaluating Hitler. It's a matter of class interests. You want to advocate something that serves the fortunes of Russia, that serves the fortunes of the Communist Party, and if that ethic requires you to praise Hitler, then you'll praise Hitler. If it requires you to condemn Hitler, then you'll condemn Hitler. So again, nothing like an objective set of values in Marxism. Now that's so much for ethics. What about religion? Well, we're all familiar with Marx's statement that religion, and when he says religion, of course, he means Christianity. That's what all of these people mean. Christianity is the opiate of the people. What does that mean? Well, that means that Christianity is an ideology concocted to keep the workers in their place, to make the workers be satisfied with their lot. See, in the New Testament, Paul doesn't tell the slaves to rebel against their masters. He tells them to obey their masters because they will belong to Christ. They will have their reward in the next life. So Marx says Christianity aims at keeping the workers in their place, holding back the revolution. But for Marx, the revolution is the only thing that can bring help to these people. Marx didn't even like, Marx recognized, as anybody must recognize, that Christianity has often helped the poor. The abolition of slavery, the taking care of widows and orphans, all the social improvements that Christianity has been responsible for. Marx knows about that, but he condemns that too. Even when Christianity is at its best, even when Christianity is the most at its most prophetic, Marx says it's not enough. Because if you encourage people to think that Christianity can solve all the problems, then the revolution will never happen. And Marx believes that the only thing that will improve the lot of these people is the revolution. So you have to get rid of Christianity or else you won't have the revolution. You can read some of my comments here. I think sometimes Marx is incisive in that there are some societies that are set up so that the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. Certainly there's some what are called aristocratic societies in Latin America, certainly like that. And this is why perhaps Marxism has taken such deep roots in Latin America. Liberation theology has developed very powerful representatives in Latin America. So Marxism is helpful in describing how that happens. But remember that Marx is wrong about a lot of things. Marx is wrong about the proletariat rising up in revolution. That never happened. You know, there have been several Marxist revolutions, communist revolutions. They've never been spearheaded by factory workers. They've never been spearheaded by the proletariat. In Russia, in China, it was the peasants that rose up under Mao. And so in Russia, when it became the Soviet Union, the revolution was spearheaded by some professional revolutionaries under the leadership of Lenin. And there was no mass movement, really. It was a coup d'etat that took over the state from the Tsars. And of course, remember that in Marxism, there's ethical relativism and a kind of absoluteness of class values that produces a rationalist-irrationalist dialectic. Well, I say more about that in my ethics book, Doctrine of the Christian Life.